Earlier this week, we managed to swing by to Canon Europe and get our hands on the new C500 Mark II for a few hours. During this time, we looked over the camera physically, shot some ISO tests, some overexposure tests, and shot some very quick test shots in our beautiful industrial car park. I explored the initial tech specs in our explained video, which you can check out using this link. So in this video, I'll be going over some questions I had in that and looking at our tests. Let's start with the new lens mount system. We had three of the new interchangeable lens mounts, the PL, EF, and locking EF. We stuck mainly with the PL mount throughout our time using it, but did swap it out a few times to get an understanding of how this system has been designed, as it's the first time that Canon has produced something like this. Before, you had to send your camera back into a Canon service center to be swapped. For the new system, you need to simply remove these four M3 hex screws. You can then pull off the mount. Under here, you can see the four locating pins and two shims for adjusting your back focus, and then the 10-pin connector for lens data. Not only is this system solid, but it's also extremely easy to use. Canon looks to have done a great job here. The back module system is one of the most interesting parts of the new system from Canon. The physical design of the Canon Cine cameras is one thing that has been pretty hit or miss over the past few years. The C700 was massive, the C200 has two versions due to the viewfinder not making it great for gimbal use, and the C300 Mark II's monitor / XLR combo unit was annoying to mount in certain configurations and could also make your camera very tall very quickly. We had all three of the units currently available, Unit 1, Unit 2, and the EVF V50. The whole system is extremely well thought out, and once you have attached one of the modules, they feel like they're part of the camera. They are really easy to attach and remove. One thing I wish they had done though was to make the screws captive on everything, as I can see screws going missing on set a lot. I think the two popular modules will be the viewfinder and the Unit 2. During the very brief time I had to shoot, we shot with no module on the Ronin 2, and then when handheld, used the Unit 2. This meant that with no module, it was so much easier to balance on the Ronin 2 instead of other Cinema EOS line, apart from the C200B obviously, which is the configuration that we spent half of the shoot in. We then went over to the Unit 2 so we could shoot in handheld and still power our Teradek and Nucleus M by using VLOC batteries with DTAP outputs. With this module on the back of the camera, it feels really well balanced and nice to operate. If I was to compare it to something, I would say it feels like a slightly heavier but smaller C700. The new monitor is only 0.3 of an inch bigger than the old LM-V1, but it looks and feels a decent bit larger. This could be a pro or a con depending on what kind of shooter you are. I think it does make sense that this camera comes with a bigger monitor, but you can purchase the LM-V1 and use it with the C500 Mark II if you want a slightly smaller LCD, when reducing the size and weight of your rig is crucial. As with the LM-V1, you have a 1/4 inch bracket on the side. This will make mounting it however you want easy. Arri, Bright Tangerine, and Vocas have already shown off their cage and rigging systems, but I'm sure we will see a few from the regular accessory manufacturers as well come out over the next couple of months. One thing I did like was the new screen layout that allows you to see the whole image with the information being pushed to the outer parts of the monitor. I didn't get to explore image stabilization as much as I would have liked to, but this isn't the same sensor-based IBIS that you have in cameras like the S1H or A7Ss. This uses data from the lens to electronically crop the image. This in theory means you should get slightly better stabilization than you would in post, but I do want to do some proper comparisons before forming a more in-depth opinion. We shot with the IBIS off during our handheld shots and stabilized in post using DaVinci Resolve. I'll be shooting some more tests on this in our full review. The anamorphic modes were one thing I was interested in, as I didn't have much experience shooting with the anamorphic modes on the C700 full frame, but it is the same as that. When selecting anamorphic in the menu, you can only select a de-squeeze amount. This will then apply the squeeze and a crop. However, when you hit record, you'll be recording the entire 5.9K sensor readout. You will then have to apply a squeeze and a crop in post. This image is using our Atlas Anamorphic 40mm and it's the full sensor readout without any cropping or de-squeezing. As Netflix require 2880 by 2880 active photosides for 2x1 anamorphic, you can see when we drag the clip into a sequence of that size, it covers and then some. This is a really exciting feature because it's one of the only cameras in its price range that offer comparable anamorphic field of views to the traditional Academy Anamorphic 4PERF standard of 18.6mm. Before getting into the image quality, I had some other random thoughts and notes that don't justify their own sections. It seemed to munch through batteries. I want to test this more though. It uses a 4-pin XLR power supply instead of the regular CA-A10 used with the C200 and C300 Mark II. Audio controls on the right side aren't ideal for shoulder use or subtle operation. The top handle now attaches via a cold shoe and then screws down. The screw for the top handle is now angular and captive. You have 6 quarter-inch threads on the top for accessories. For our ISO and overexposure test, we shot using just the C500 Mark II. But we'll be doing comparisons when we get the camera again for a longer period of time. We started looking off at the ISO performance of the camera. We lit for middle grey on our colour chart. Our base settings were ISO 800, 25p at 180 degree shutter, and f1.4 using our Sigma 50mm art lens. As you can expect from the Canon, the skin tones are really nice. Colours are rich and deep and really accurate. From ISO 400 to 1600, it's really clean, with 3200 is where it ramps up and 12800 is where I'd say you need some serious noise reduction. Colors are held really well as you increase the ISO, and detail is also held well up to 12800, but at 25600, you start to lose a lot. Overall, this is pretty decent for a camera that doesn't have a dual native ISO sensor like most cameras hitting the market recently. We then moved on to our overexposure tests. For this, we exposed for middle grey off our chart again. Our base settings were ISO 800 at T11, and then we opened up the iris stop for 6 stops. The camera holds colour really, really well until around 5 stops over, where colours start to break. Skin also breaks at around 5 stops over, but at 4, you will be able to retain colour and skin detail well. After we had shot our tests, we only had an hour and a bit left to get the camera prepped, rigged, and get shooting. We ventured out into our car park and shot some quick glamour shots of this beautiful Porsche. We shot using a Ronin II, a Canon Sumire 50mm and an Atlas 40mm 2x anamorphic lens. I wish we had more time to shoot with the camera, but I'm pretty happy with what we managed to capture in such a short period of time. I can see this camera being very popular for gimbal operation. It's a great size and design to mount onto the Ronin II nice and easily. We managed to get the camera with a 50mm Canon Sumire lens, a single Nucleus M motor, an MMB2 with a Black ProMist and circular polarizer, a Teradek 500 LT-TX and a BPA-30 to power the camera. Once it was rigged, the gimbal handled fine and even without a ready rig, the Ronin II was still pretty easy to operate. I was actually quite surprised the 5.9K XF AVC and Cinema RAW light both imported into both Resolve and Premiere without any issues. Regular 4K CRM is already pretty taxing on our computers, and this is still the case with the 5.9K stuff. When viewing the footage on our 4K TV Logic monitor, the footage looks really detailed and sharp, even with the lens wide open. The dynamic range looks decent, but I do want to do some more experimenting with the camera in a more challenging scene with more dynamic range and some more intense motion. Overall, our first impressions of the C500 Mark II are really positive. The image out of the camera is really nice, and the array of quality of life improvements will make the camera much easier to handle than previous C-series cameras. When we get hold of the camera next, we'll be doing a more in-depth test and comparison, so make sure you subscribe and hit the notification button for that.